grateful to you and thankful to you, Peter. Thank you for being here as we get into the anniversary of the humanity of the
though most of the world do not follow our ways. We know that there is a group of people who are the inspirers to our world. And we're going to use them more and more. And it's going to be you, along with your companions.
If you turn to Psalm chapter 37, verse 4, It says, delight ourselves in the Lord. For He,
our God, who wants us to be saved and bring us into a new creation, is God.
I just want to tell all the youth that God cares for you. There was a time when I was close to becoming an atheist and how He changed me. Today, my parents are still Hindu, but they let me practice my faith in the same house. And today, I found the happiness, and I just pray to God that someday they would also find the happiness so that I can be with them, you know, with my God in the heavenly home. And I would like to just thank God for all the mercies that He has done.
And you want, once again, welcome all of you, every one of you here, Whether you study the spices or no, please come and join us as we meet together to thank God.
For this college that is waiting for the final charter to become a university.
You will say, I find no pleasure in them.
Even a child is known by his actions, by whether his conduct is pure and right.
How can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands.
My son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart. For they will prolong your life many years and bring you prosperity. Lord, with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge me, and he will make your paths straight.
Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
For him of praise, I request you all to turn your hymnals to Psalm number 12.
Thank you. himself.
He looks very much Indian. Right? Okay. Mr. Daniel is working as the global. This is for the benefit of the church members we have gathered here. Maybe we are going to see them for the first time. Father Jonathan Cahill comes to us from Spain, and he comes to us from a very
home. So in my house, all the boys were in my room and all the girls
were in another room.
And it was like that until I was 25 years of age. That's when I flew across to meet my girlfriend in Australia. By the way, Pastor Gary last night was at his marriage to the most beautiful woman in the world. I don't believe that. He hasn't seen my wife yet. But anyway, and he said to his eyes and to my eyes as well, she's the most beautiful. But anyway, my brother Charles, my older brother Charles and I, we shared a single bed that was not larger than that until I was 25 years of age. But we had to learn to sleep together. So when I faced the ceiling, my brother Charles faced the ceiling. When I turned to the left, he turned to the left. Turned to the right, he turned to the right. We never woke up, it was like automatic. We were on autopilot. We learned to sleep together. And sometimes in the middle of the night, we would be woken up, you know, by what we, maybe we thought it was mosquitoes, but eventually it was like rain was falling because our house was leaking. And in the middle of the night, we kind of moved the bed around in the room, we played music on bed until we could position ourselves in a way that we could sleep the rest of the night. That until I was 25 years of age. Then I flew across to meet Rosemary, my wife. But when I arrived in Australia, she lived with her parents in a two-bedroom house. We were not married yet, so one room for her parents and one room for her. So I had to sleep in the lounge room. Didn't have a room for myself. And then we got married. And when we got married, praise the Lord, we moved in the same bedroom. Amen? So I didn't know what it was to have a bedroom on my own. And now I come back from Zimbabwe, I end up in my mother's house. She is living with my sister, just two of them. All my brothers and sisters had left home. In a two-person house, there were four bedrooms in that house. The fortunes of my family had completely changed. And my mother made sure that she gave me the largest bedroom. And I stretched all night, you know, and enjoyed my personal bedroom. And my mother would come and wake me up every morning. And she would put 40 rupees in my hands. I said, Mom, what's this for? She said, Son, this is your pocket money for the day. I said, Mother, I know that pastors are not very wealthy, but I have a few dollars with me, so you don't need to worry. She said, No. I want you to take that. So religiously, my mother would give me 40 rupees every morning for my pocket money. I think that my mother was trying to make up for the legal luxuries of life that she had not been able to provide for me when I was growing up. And as she left the room in the morning, I lie down and I reflected on my life. I reflected on where God had taken me to where I am today. I stand here only by the grace and the mercy of the living God. And I stand here this morning to tell you that God is good. If you step up and put your life in His hands, there is no telling what He can do for you in terms of the meaning and the purpose that He would add to your life. And so I'm going to invite you this morning to take the step of faith and to put your life in the hands of the living God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Right there before me, gave me some advice. This Gilbert, don't try to look for good jobs and universities and all that. Whatever your friends find to do in your early days, do it, because you will need the money for housing and for all the little simple things of life. Just do anything to start with, and then later you can think education and proper career. I thought it was good advice. And so I made it known to my church community that I was in the job, lookout. And one Sabbath after the service, a brother came to me and said, I understand you're looking for a job. I said, yes. He said, well, when can you start? I said, on Monday. He said, oh really? I said, yes. And I didn't think it was important to ask what the job was because I was committed to do anything. So he said, okay, let's start Monday. I said, what time do we start? He said, 5 a.m. I smiled, I thought it was a jerk, and I said, what time? He said, yes, 5 a.m. And then he says, do you have a car? I said, no. He said, I'm the production manager, and I have to be there at 4:30, so if you're happy with that, I'll pick you up at 4 o'clock. It was in the middle of winter,
And I was waiting for him to say, no, it's a joke. It was no joke. So I went home and I told my wife, I'm starting work on Monday morning, and I'm starting at 5 in the morning. He's going to pick me up at 4. It was in the middle of winter. I had my big coat on, and I'm standing at the street corner. It's still dark. My friend picks me up, and I say, where are we going? He said, you'll soon find out. It was a factory. It was a potato packing factory. And I said, what's my job? He said, come follow me. It was a place where they bought large quantities of potatoes, washed them, they came on a conveyor belt, and finally they were automatically packaged in 5 kilos, which came on a spinning table, and there was a woman there putting five kilo packs in a paper bag. And my job was to lift 25 kilos of potatoes, put it on a conveyor belt, sew it, put it on a pallet until I had 40, put it on a grabbing at the back of the factory with a pallet jack, and then run back, and there would be about 10 bags waiting for me. By the time we got to the first break at 10 o'clock, I could hardly walk. I went and I sat down and I thought about my commitment to do this job. When I got home that afternoon, my wife took a good look at me and she said, where have you been? I said, work. She said, you're not going there anymore. I said, no, I can't do that. They will think I am sick. I committed myself to this job, so I have to go back. The next day I went back, and the week went past. 2 weeks later, my friend came and says, work is going really well, and we've got some overtime. Do you want to do some overtime? I thought about it, and I said, okay, I'll do some overtime. So every day now, another 2 hours, I'm staying in the workplace. After another 2 weeks, he says, business is going really well. We've got work on Sunday. Do you want to work on Sunday? I said, okay, I'll work on Sunday. And there I was, every day getting home late, it was dark. I'm working on Sunday. And you know what? I did not want to be late for work at all. By that time, Kevin did not pick me up, and I had to catch the train to go to work. I wanted to be at work on time because you clock your card, because the more hours you get, the more pay you get. So one morning, my alarm clock failed me, and I woke up about 10 minutes before the train was to leave. And I just grabbed something and I ran to the station. When I arrived at the station, I heard the train, you know, the sound of the train departing. And I said to myself, I cannot be late for work. And so a bad idea came to me. So I pretended to be sick. So my body went into this, and I called out, stop the train! And the station master saw me, and he blew his whistle, and stopped the train. Now everybody in the train is looking out the window, so I had to stay like that. I walked in, and I sat on the train, until people were watching me. When I got on the train, I had to pretend not to be well until I got to my workplace. Every day I was breaking my back, every day I was overtime. And do you know what was the best day of the week for me? What was it? I knew you would give me this good religious answer. Sabbath was good. Yes, it was good because we did not work and we could rest. But there was another day that was even more exciting. What was that? Payday. I was prepared to work that hard, to deprive my family of my presence. I was prepared to break my back at the potato factory because of the money. The more you work, the more you get paid. That's how life works. That is before the taxman hits you. The more you work, the more you get paid. Life functions like that. It's like that at school. If you study hard, you pass your exam. You don't study, you don't make it. I had a teacher who used to pray before our exam. And he would pray, dear God, I pray that you will remind the students only of what they had faithfully memorized. And those who had not memorized were in serious trouble. It's like that. You get what you deserve. It's the same in spite of the havoc in the traffic in Pune and Mumbai. Last night, or the night before, we were driving in traffic, and my driver was going to take a left turn on the red light, but he stopped. And I said, why are you stopping today and not the other day? He said, there's a policeman right there. One day he fired those policemen, and he knew that he was going to be on the wrong side of the law. And he was, if he was on the wrong side of the law, he would be punished. That's how life works. You do the right thing, you get rewarded. You do the wrong thing, you get punished. And then we bring the same kind of thinking in religious life. You get what you deserve. You're good, you get rewarded. You're bad, you get punished. It is like that in Hinduism. Salvation is through the way of moksha. You know the four paths, the way of action, the way of knowledge, the way of devotion, the royal road. It's a ladder you have to climb. If you climb well, you get salvation. It's the same for Buddhism. The blissful state of nirvana is reached through the nine eightfold paths. Right understanding, right result, right speech, right action, right occupation, right effort, right contemplation, right meditation. You do that well, you climb the ladder, you get to nirvana. In Islam, there's a different sequence. It's a mixture of the grace of God and the performance of the Muslims. So at the end of the day, there's like a balancing act that is done. Your good works outweigh your bad works, and Allah decides in which side of the fence you are. But there is ladder climbing. Now, this morning I come to Christianity. What is the difference? What is the difference? Is salvation about ladder climbing? A young man wanted to find out. If you have your Bibles, go with me to Matthew chapter 19. He's a teacher, right? Nobody questions the existence of Jesus. Everybody acknowledges Jesus as one of the good teachers, one of the great teachers. And here this young man comes to him with this 1 million rupee question. What must I do in order to get eternal life? Now, this guy was a young man. And if we read what Mark says and what Luke says, we realize that this man was very successful. He was young, but he was already a ruler. So he had already achieved success. He was probably, in our modern language, maybe a manager in an IT consultancy business somewhere in Bangalore, right? He was made it. He was young. He was a ruler. He was a manager. He was in charge, right? But this young man, who was already successful, already in charge of his business, and Mark tells us that he ran in the middle of the road and he threw himself at Jesus' feet and he said, teacher, teacher, what must I do to get eternal life? Sometimes we think that success in our career, materialism, is going to bring us the ultimate. This young man shows that you can be the greatest IT manager in Bangalore or in the rest of India. You might have achieved success in your career, but that will not satisfy the deep desires of your heart. And so this man now comes to the ultimate teacher with the right attitude and with the right question, and he came to the right teacher. What does Jesus say to him as we continue to read the story? Why do you ask me about what is good? Jesus replied, there is only one who is good. Now Jesus says, if you want to enter life, obey the commandments. Jesus knew the tradition. And in the way of Jesus sets him up, he says, you want to inherit eternal life? Obey the commandments. And the young man says, well, which one? And Jesus says, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, honor your father and mother, and love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, this is the ladder. Begin climbing. And the young man says, all these I have kept, the young man said, what do I still lack? Jesus doesn't say, no, you mean obey them properly. Jesus acknowledged that he had been faithful. He was a good commandment keeper. He was not only wrong. He was not only rich, he did not only have the right attitude, but he was religious. It's the kind of young man that every mother would desire for their daughter, right? Wealthy, young, academic success, success in the business, and religious.
going to church and obeying all the commandments. Oh, what else would you want? What else would you want? And Jesus does not rebuke his commandment keeping. But Jesus says, there's one more thing. Just one more thing. Now you can feel the heart of this young man pounding with expectation. One more commandment. After 27 fundamentals, I need one more. Just one more, the 28. One more rung on the ladder. I've climbed almost there. Jesus says, just one more thing. And his heart is beating fast. And Jesus says, I'm paraphrased, trust me. Trust me. You are religious, but you are independent. You are religious, but you are trying to get to heaven and to eternal life on your own merits and by your own obedience. It doesn't work like that. He says, go and sell everything you have. Give it to the poor. You will get your reward in heaven. And come to kingdom building with me. Come and follow me. In other words, trust your life in my hands. It's good that you're religious. It's good that you obey the commandments. It's good that you are successful in your career. But when we come to eternal life, you have to trust me. You have to put your life in my hands. And the young man pulled out his calculator. And he worked out how much eternal life would cost him. And when he found the bottom dollar, he said, excuse me, this is too much. And he walked away. He had come with the right attitude. He had come to the right teacher. He had come with the right question. But he left unsaved and sad. And Jesus was sad looking at this man. And now the disciples are worried because they too start to ask questions about their own eternal life. Jesus said it's very hard. It's very hard for a self-centered, independent, religious young person to enter into eternal life. And then they said, well, what about us? We've left everything. Jesus says to them, eternal life? With man, it is impossible. With man, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. In other words, when it comes to kingdom building, when it comes to entering eternal life, it is not about what you do and how religious and how good you are. Because eternal life is a gift of God when you put your life in the hands of God. And now, Jesus gives a parable that we need to look at very quickly to make a point. He's in his vineyard, and so he goes to the local employment office, and he chooses, I don't know, 20 or 30 workers for the day. And it says here in the next verse, he agreed to pay them one denarius. In other words, there was some discussion of wages that went on. Maybe they bargained, maybe they got someone from syndicate to come and discuss wages. But finally they agreed. They said, okay, we're happy with that. We discuss wages, one denarius for the day. Now, this is early in the morning. And early in the morning is the first hour. And the first hour is 6 o'clock in the morning. What time is it? What time is it? It's 6 o'clock in the morning. And you have your 30 workers now who show up in the vineyard. They put their big baskets on their back. And they're starting to climb the hills and pick up the grapes. It's still 6 o'clock in the morning. But now the sun is rising and it's getting hot and they're starting to sweat. He is a master who is full of surprises. He's got all the workers that he needs, but he surprises us in the next verse. We see in verse 3. At about the third hour, what is the third hour? If the first hour is 6 o'clock in the morning, what is the third hour? He is not the master that is driven by money, driven by gain, but he's driven by compassion. He's driven by the needs of people. And so he sees those people there doing nothing and he says, you also go and work in my vineyard and now the rest is important. I will pay you whatever is right. In other words, you are not entitled for a full day's wage because it's already 9 o'clock in the morning. So trust me. Trust me and go and work in my vineyard. You can rely on me. I am trustworthy. And now,
This new group of workers arrives on the workplace, right? And you assume that you are the hardworking people this morning. You all have started work at 6 o'clock in the morning, and you have a new bunch of workers coming in, and you say to yourself, oh, they're a bunch of lazy bums, right? They are serious about work. If they were serious about work, they would be here at 6 in the morning. The 6 o'clock in the morning people are like the people who come early for Sabbath school. Amen. The 9 o'clock people are people who don't come for the preliminaries, they go straight to the classrooms. Are you with me? Now, the master is full of surprises. And it says in the next verse, in verse 5, so they went. He went out again at the 6th hour. What is the 6th hour? What is the 6th hour? 12 o'clock. And he went again at the 9th hour. What is the 9th hour? 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And he does the same. So what is it that he does the same? He went and he saw people in need. He said, you two, go and work in my vineyard. Don't discuss wages with me. Trust me and I will give you whatever is right. Now those who come at midday, there are people who don't come for Sabbath school, they just come for the divine service. The 3 o'clock people, they don't come for the preliminaries, for the songs and all that, they come just for the sermon, right? And there is more. And we read in the next verse, it says here, in verse 6, about the 11th hour. What's the 11th hour? What time is the 11th hour? 5 o'clock in the morning, in the afternoon, there's only 1 hour for work. At about the 11th hour, he went out and he found still others standing around. He asked them, why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing? He says, because we have needs and there is no one to answer our needs. And the master says to them, you also go and work in my vineyard. Now, remember, you are the hardworking people. You started at 6 o'clock in the morning. They were hiding at 5 o'clock. By the time they get to the workplace.